Hello students, welcome to the session. So in this session we'll be discussing in detail about the alpha decay. So in this session we'll define what do you mean by alpha decay and the expression for alpha disintegration energy, and we'll be obtaining the relation between the range and energy of alpha particle, and also we'll be discussing about Geiger and Nuttall law. So these are the brief description about the session. So first let us see what do you mean by alpha decay. So during radioactive decay we have studied that whenever any radioactive substance undergoes disintegration, or there is a spontaneous disintegration, it decays or disintegrates with the emission of radiation, certain radiation, there is alpha, beta and gamma radiation. So in the previous videos we have studied about what do you mean by beta decays, that is beta minus decay, beta plus decay and electron capture process of beta decay. So now in this session we will be learning about alpha decay. So during beta decay we have seen that whenever any radioactive substance, that is the parent nucleus, undergoes the beta decay, so the newly formed daughter nucleus will be having a change in its atomic number. So but its mass number remains the same with the emission of the beta particle, right? Similarly, now let us see initially. So what happens to this radioactive parent nucleus whenever it undergoes alpha decay, or when do we say that the radioactive substance is undergoing alpha decay? So let us consider there is a radioactive parent nucleus X which is having atomic number Z and mass number A. So if this undergoes alpha decay, so the newly formed the daughter nucleus will be having atomic number less by 2 units and mass number less by 4 units. That means the atomic number will be less by 2 and the mass number will be less by 4, and with the emission of the alpha particle. Okay, so this is the process, that is what we call it as an alpha decay. So there is the process in which the alpha particle is spontaneously disintegrated from a radioactive nucleus, such that the newly formed daughter nucleus will be having atomic number less by 2 units and mass number by 4 units, along with the emission of the alpha particle. Of course, there is certain energy that is being emitted with this alpha particle. Okay, so that is what we call it as a disintegration energy. Now we know that the difference in the mass of the parent nucleus and the mass of the daughter nucleus that is formed. So this will be appearing as the disintegration energy in the form of kinetic energy for the alpha particle during the alpha decay. That is, so from where this alpha particle gets energy means, according to Einstein's mass energy relation, the difference in the mass between the parent nucleus and the daughter nucleus. Why? Because atomic number here it is Z and mass number is A, but the daughter nucleus is having atomic number less by 2 units and mass number 4 units. So definitely there will be difference in the mass of the parent nucleus and the daughter nucleus. So therefore the difference in this mass will be converted into energy, and that will be appearing as the disintegration energy, that is in the form of the, or this is seen in the form of the kinetic energy of the alpha particle. So this is how the alpha particles get their energy. Now let us see some of the examples for alpha decay. So suppose we know that is uranium 92-238 nucleus. When this undergoes alpha decay, so there is formation of a new element, that is thorium, with its atomic number less by 2 units. So therefore atomic number for thorium will be 90. And mass number will be decreased by 4 units. So therefore the mass number for the thorium will be 234, and along with the alpha particle that is being emitted. So if you measure the mass and charge of alpha particle, so this will be equal to the mass and charge of the helium nucleus. So therefore alpha particles are identified as the helium nucleus. Okay, so therefore in the place of alpha we can also consider He2O4. Okay, so if you balance this equation again, this will be equal to the initial conditions, right? Okay, so this is one example. Okay, the second example is we have radon 88-226. So and after disintegration the new element form has an atomic number less by 2 units, so it is 86, and this is mass number decreased by 4 units, so therefore it will be 222 plus the helium. Okay, so these are the two examples for the disintegration, that is alpha disintegration. So the alpha particle which is being emitted in this reaction or in this reaction, so the energy of alpha particles during decay will be approximately 4 MeV to 10 MeV. So that is the kinetic energy of the alpha particle that is being emitted during the alpha decay will be of the range from 4 MeV, that is 4 mega electron volt to approximately 10 mega electron volt. See, for example, in this reaction, that is when uranium undergoes alpha decay, and if it is forming a thorium nucleus, okay, so the alpha particle that is being emitted here, so we'll have an energy of approximately 5 mega electron volt, okay, so which is in the range of 4 and 10 MeV. So therefore, so different parent nucleus disintegrate, okay, so to give alpha particles of different energies, but the overall energy will be in the range of 4 MeV to 10 MeV, okay. So those alpha particles whose size is very large, that is, if the number of nucleons is, that is, what do you mean by nucleons? That is, protons plus neutrons, combinedly known as nucleons. So if the number of nucleons is greater than 200, then this alpha particle or the parent nucleus will be unstable. So in order to gain stability, so it undergoes beta decay. Okay, so for the there is a dot parent nucleus which is having mass number which is greater than 200. So we say that the heavy nucleus will undergo alpha decay. So why? Because the short range nuclear force, we know that nuclear force has a property of short range. So what do you mean by short range? Means it will be, that is, nuclear force will be applicable or it will be valid only to a few Fermi meters. Okay, so beyond that it cannot be strong force. Okay, so in order to overcome the repulsive force between the protons, so therefore in order to gain stability, it undergoes the alpha decay by reducing their size. So the disintegration energy during the beta decay, so that can be written as, that is, disintegration energy is equal to mass of the parent minus the mass of the daughter nucleus minus the mass of the alpha particle emitted into C square. So this is what we called as the mathematical equation of the disintegration energy for the alpha decay. So during beta decay, we had mentioned that is some conservation laws. Right, so there is conservation of charge, conservation of mass, conservation of linear momentum, conservation of angular momentum. So all those things were discussed in the beta decay. So similarly, in this case, that is, in case of alpha decay also, so if you are able to see alpha decay, means then all the laws, that is, conservation laws, will be satisfied in alpha decay also. See, here in this example, we can see that there is Z represents the total number of protons, okay, that is the charge, okay. So if you see on the right hand side, that is 86 plus 2, it is nothing but the total number of protons after the products, okay. Now here we have, what initially we had 88 protons. So here if you add, so there is conservation of charge. And here also we can see that on the right hand side, 222 plus 4, it will be 226, so which is nothing but the mass number, that is, there is conservation of, there is law of conservation of mass is been satisfied. And similarly, law of conservation of linear momentum, see here we can see that conservation of linear momentum, since we are getting a kinetic energy for the alpha particle during alpha decay, so here we can conclude that there is alpha decay, or the parent nucleus will be recoiling in the opposite direction than that of the alpha particle. So definitely, since it is having, there is, alpha particle is showing some energy, okay, of the order of 5 mega electron volt, so which is little bit large, so definitely there will be conservation of linear momentum and angular momentum. And of course, we have conservation of energy also. Why? Because the difference in the mass between the parent and the daughter nucleus. So if you measure the difference between these two and the energy equivalent or the energy that is obtained due to the disintegration of alpha particle, so it will be equal to the energy that is energy of the alpha particle. So therefore, we say that the law of conservation of energy is also been satisfied. So that's why we are able to see the alpha decay. So that is, it means that we are seeing alpha decay means there are certain conservation laws that has been satisfied. Okay, so there is no other particle that is been emitted in alpha decay as that of the beta decay. Okay, so in beta decay we have another particle, there is neutrino and anti-neutrino particles are emitted during beta decay. So but in case of alpha decay, so we have only the alpha particle emitted, no any elementary particles are been emitted in the case of alpha decay. Now let us calculate or obtain the expression for alpha disintegration energy. Alpha disintegration energy. So in the starting itself we have discussed, that is, what do you mean by disintegration energy means. So the total energy released during the alpha decay process is what we call it as an alpha disintegration energy. Clear students, alpha disintegration energy is defined as the total energy that is being released during the alpha decay will be known as the alpha disintegration energy. See, at the time of alpha decay, okay, so here we have the parent nucleus, right? So let us consider this parent nucleus as Z with atomic number, parent nucleus X with atomic number Z and mass number A. So this is what we call it as parent nucleus. So during alpha decay or after alpha decay, so the newly formed daughter nucleus, this is your daughter nucleus, and along with the alpha particle, that is nothing but the helium nucleus. Initially, this parent nucleus will be at rest. So therefore, the velocity is zero and its linear momentum is zero. Now, after the alpha decay, so if this is the direction in which the alpha particle is being recoiled, and in this the direction opposite to this direction, so the daughter nucleus, that is daughter nucleus Y with atomic number Z minus 2 and mass number Z minus 4 will get recoiled. So therefore, there is this angular moment, this the linear momentum of this parent nucleus and the linear momentum of this alpha particle are in opposite direction and equal in magnitude. So therefore, the law of conservation of linear momentum after reaction and before reaction is being conserved. Okay. Now, see, whenever this alpha particle is being emitted with a definite or certain amount of kinetic energy, so they will be definitely having a momentum. Why? Because linear momentum P is equal to M into V. So kinetic energy is given by the formula half mv square, right? So therefore, if they are having velocity means they will be definitely having momentum and kinetic energy. Okay, keep this in mind. Okay, whenever we say that there is a momentum, definitely it will be associated with certain kinetic energy. Why? Because we have the velocity, so therefore they have the kinetic energy due to motion, and we have the momentum due to its velocity and its mass. So the direction in which this alpha particle is being getting recoiled, so in the direction opposite to this, there is a residual nucleus or the daughter nucleus will regain. So since they are recoiling, they also have a certain velocity. So they also have a certain momentum, but opposite to that of this alpha particle. So therefore, the residual nucleus must also have a certain kinetic energy also. Okay, so therefore, we can apply the law of conservation of angular momentum to calculate the alpha disintegration energy. Okay, so now if you come into this derivation part or the calculation part, so let us consider that Md is the mass of the daughter nucleus and Vd is the velocity of the daughter nucleus, that is the recoil velocity of the daughter nucleus or the residual nucleus. Okay, and in the similar manner, let us consider m alpha is the mass of the alpha particle and v alpha is the velocity of the alpha particle. So, according to the law of conservation of linear momentum, so what was the initial momentum of the parent nucleus? It was zero. Why? Because it was at rest. And now the linear momentum of the daughter nucleus can be written as a product of mass and velocity, and similarly the linear momentum of the alpha particle can be written as m alpha into v alpha. So the previous equation that we had is 0 is equal to mass of the daughter nucleus into velocity of the daughter nucleus plus mass of the alpha particle into velocity of the alpha particle. Now, if I simplify this, we can write the mass of alpha particle into velocity of alpha particle is equal to minus md into vd, right? So, this is the equation that is being obtained, and let us take this as equation number 1 by using the law of conservation of angular momentum. Now, by using the law of conservation of energy, okay, we can write, that is using Einstein's mass energy relation, that is mass of the parent nucleus into c square, this is equal to mass of the daughter nucleus into c square plus mass of the alpha particle into c square into q. Q is nothing but known as the disintegration energy. And where Q will be known as the energy released during the alpha decay process. Now, the sum of the kinetic energy of alpha particle and the recoil velocity is called as the alpha particle disintegration energy. That is, the sum of the kinetic energy of the daughter nucleus or the recoil nucleus plus the kinetic energy of the alpha particle will be known as the alpha particle disintegration energy. So, this is the definition of alpha particle disintegration energy. That is, disintegration energy, alpha particle disintegration energy is nothing but the sum of the kinetic energy of alpha particle and the kinetic energy of the daughter nucleus or the recoil nucleus. So, from equation 1, we can write, that is Vd is equal to minus m alpha into V alpha divided by md. Okay. See, here we can simplify this equation as Vd, keep it as it is, send this minus side to the left hand side, and this is m alpha into V alpha on the left hand side divided by md. Okay. So, I am writing this equation directly here. So, therefore, Vd is equal to minus m alpha V alpha divided by md. So, square on both the sides now. So, what do you get? Vd square is equal to m alpha into V alpha divided by md. Here it is minus the whole square. So, this will be minus square, it will be plus m alpha square V alpha square divided by md square. Now, substitute this equation in this, that is equation number 2. So, we have Q is equal to 1 by half mass of the daughter nucleus into m alpha square v alpha square divided by md square plus half into md into vd square. Now, this square and md gets cancelled. So, therefore, remaining terms will be Q is equal to 1 by 2 m alpha square into v alpha square divided by md plus half md into, this is m alpha into v alpha the square. Now, Q is equal to, see here 1 by 2, m alpha m alpha, and v alpha square is common, so take it outside. M alpha v alpha square, I'll take it outside, and remaining here it is m alpha divided by md plus 1, or q is equal to 1 by 2 into m alpha into v alpha the whole square into 1 plus m alpha divided by md. Okay, I'll rewrite this equation as q is equal to e alpha into 1 plus m alpha divided by md, where e alpha is equal to half m alpha into v alpha the square. So this is known as the kinetic energy of alpha particle. Now this is the expression for the disintegration energy of alpha particle, that is equal to e alpha into 1 plus m alpha divided by md, where e alpha is nothing but the kinetic energy of the alpha particle that is being emitted. Okay, so continuing with this alpha decay, now let us study what do you mean by range of alpha particle. See, we all know that in our previous sessions we have discussed that alpha particles have high ionizing power and less penetrating power. So the penetrating power is less, but they have the high ionizing power. So whenever the alpha particle or the alpha rays passes through any gas, they ionize them. So during ionization, so what do you mean by range of alpha particle means the maximum distance that the alpha particle can travel through the gas without the change in its kinetic energy. So this is what we call it as a range of alpha particle. So range of alpha particle is defined as the distance through which an alpha particle travel in a gas without loss in the kinetic energy. So this distance that is being traveled by the alpha particle in any gas without loss in kinetic energy will be defined as the range of the alpha particle. So after this range, the kinetic energy of the alpha particle will be completely zero. Okay, so after this range, that is the maximum distance through which the alpha particle can travel without losing its kinetic energy is known as the range. So after crossing this range or this distance, the kinetic energy of the alpha particle will be completely zero, that is they loses all their kinetic energy. Now let us look into the factors on which the range depends, that is range of alpha particle depends. So the range of alpha particle depends on, the first factor is it is directly proportional to the velocity of the emitted alpha particle. So the range of alpha particle is directly proportional to the velocity of the emitted alpha particle. So that is, we can write the range is directly proportional to the initial velocity of the emitted alpha particle. So this is the first factor on which the range depends. So the second factor on which the range depends is, it depends on the nature of radioactive element or the substance. So second factor is the range of alpha particle will depend on the nature of the radioactive element, and the range will also depend on the nature of the gas through which they pass. So this is the third factor. And the fourth factor is the range of alpha particle, okay, is inversely proportional to the pressure of the gas. So where P will be the pressure of the gas. So the range of alpha particles depends on the following factors. One is the velocity, that is range of the alpha particle is directly proportional to its velocity. It depends on the nature of the radioactive element or the substance, and it also depends on the nature of the gas through which they pass, and it is inversely proportional to the, that is range is inversely proportional to the pressure of the gas. So these are the properties on which the range of the gas will depend. Now we can see that the range of alpha particle will be very small, of the order of 10 to the power of minus 3 millimeter for alpha particle with energy, okay, that is a alpha particle energy of few mega electron volts. So for those alpha particles which are having an energy of few mega electron volts, so their range will be of the order of 10 to the power of minus 3 millimeter or few centimeters also. Now let us see what is the relationship between range and energy of alpha particle. Now, so the relationship between the range and energy was first studied by a person, that is H. Geiger, and he obtained an mathematical formula for the relation between the range and velocity as, that is range is directly proportional to V cube, that is velocity cube. Why? Because we have studied, that is the range of alpha particle will depend on the velocity. So the relation between the range and velocity can be written as, that is range is directly proportional to V cube. Okay. Or if I remove this proportionality constant, we shall include a constant that is known as A into V cube, where range is in meters, okay, and velocity will be in terms of meter per second. So now this equation is what we called as the Geiger's law. Okay, so that is the relation between velocity and the range is known as the Geiger law. And we all know that there is the energy of the alpha particle is directly proportional to the velocity square, or this implies, that is e to the power of 1 by 2 is directly proportional to velocity. So here we can write R is equal to A into, it is V cube here. So in the place of V, I'll write it e to the power of half whole to the power of cube. So therefore, range is equal to A into e to the power of 3 by 2. So this is the relation between the range and the energy, where A is a constant. Okay. So this is the relationship between the energy and the range. Now, if E is in measured in terms of, that is E will be in terms of mega electron volt, then range will be in terms of centimeter. Okay. And the value of this constant is approximately 9.416 into 10 to the power of minus 24. So let us take that RS and RA are ranges in, there is ranges of alpha particle in solid and air, then this range in case of alpha particle in case of solid and in case of air is given by the relation, that is 0.312 into RA into A to the power of 1 by 2 divided by rho, okay, so where rho is nothing but the density of solid, that is what we are using, and A is its mass number. So the next important topic to be discussed in this session is Geiger-Nuttall law. Okay, so now what is Geiger Natal law, or basically what does these gives or relates between these? So this Geiger Natal law gives the relationship between the range R and the decay constant of alpha particle. That is, this Geiger and Natal observe that is there is a definite relationship between the range of alpha particle and the decay constant of the alpha particle. So this is given by Geiger-Natal law. So once again, students, so this Geiger-Natal law will give the relationship between the range of the alpha particle and the decay constant of the radioactive substance which is emitting the alpha particle. So now let us see what is the relation between them. So that is, it is given as log of the decay constant to the base 10 will be equal to A plus B into log R to the base 10, where A and B are constants. And there is A and B are constants of the radioactive elements. So the constant B is same for any type of radioactive nucleus. So we call that as series, and A is different for different series. We get radium series, thorium series, uranium series, like that. Okay. So this constant A will be different for different series. Okay, but this constant B will be same for all the series. It, irrespective of the series, this constant B is same for any series, but this constant A will differ for different series. Now, if we plot a graph by taking log of the range along the x-axis and log of lambda of different element along the y-axis, we can see that there will be a straight line that will be obtained. So as we have discussed, so what we are going to take, we are going to take log of R. R is nothing but the range of alpha particle along the x-axis, and log of lambda on the y-axis for different series. It was seen that the graph between log of R and log of lambda was a straight line for different series. So let us consider, this is for the uranium series, and this will be for thorium series, okay, and this for the, and the last one for the actinium series. So U is uranium series, and TH will be thorium series, and the last one is actinium series. So if you just take one series, okay, it's more than enough. I have plotted three series. So there is, if you look at any series, the relation, that is, if you plot log of R for the alpha particle emitted by uranium or by thorium or by actinium versus the decay constant of different elements, okay, so all these will be a straight line, okay. So this is the relationship between log of lambda and log of R. So what can be concluded with this graph and with the Geiger-Natal law, this equation means, see, we can see that the graph between log R and log of lambda is a straight line. It means that these two are directly proportional. So therefore, we can say that there is the range will depend on the energy. We all know that. Okay, so therefore we can conclude that those radioactive nucleus which are having more value of decay constant, so then they emit a alpha particle of high energy. Okay, so this is very important. That is, this is the conclusion of Geiger-Natal law. So that is, for those radioactive nuclei which is having what is a longer decay constant, it means that they are having a long range. So they are having long range means definitely they will be having a high energy. That is, the alpha particle emitted by that particular radioactive element which is have a longer value of lambda, so it will be having high energy. Okay, so this is the overall picture or the conclusion that can be obtained from the Geiger-Natal law. We shall repeat once again, students. From this graph, we are seeing that It may be for uranium, or it may be thorium, or it may be actinium series. So let us consider the uranium series itself. Here we are seeing the in the graph, that is, if you are plotting the graph between log of range of the alpha particle emitted by uranium and the decay constant of uranium, that is log of decay constant of uranium on the y-axis, here we can see that it is a straight line. So if you are getting a straight line between any two physical quantity, means it means that these two are directly proportional, right? So therefore we can see that there is the range of alpha particle will be directly proportional to the decay constant. So what does it mean? So it means that, so whichever radioactive nucleus is having a larger value of the decay constant, it means that range is wrong, range is longer. So we all know that range depends on, that is, depends on the kinetic energy of the alpha particle. So if the range is long, means definitely the alpha particle emitted by this series will be having very high energy. So this is the overall conclusion of this Geiger-Nuttall law. So which is a very good result that is being obtained from this law. So from the previous relations, that is, we have seen from Geiger law. So that is from Geiger's law. We have seen that the range of alpha particle is directly proportional to the velocity q, right? So where v alpha, let us take it as the velocity of the velocity of the alpha particle, and e alpha as the energy of alpha particle. Okay, now, and we also know that the kinetic energy of alpha particle is given by the equation half m v square, that is m alpha, that is mass of the alpha particle and velocity of the alpha particle. Or we can write the energy of the alpha particle is directly proportional to the velocity square of the alpha particle. Why? Because mass is constant and 1 by 2 is constant. So therefore we can write, that is, r alpha is directly proportional to e alpha to the power of 3 by 2, right? Now, see, we have Geiger-Nuttall law equation as log of lambda to the base 10, this is equal to a plus b into log of r to the base 10, okay? But here we have seen that the log of alpha is directly proportional to e to the power of 3 by 2. So therefore, now we can write log of r to the base 10 is equal to, that is, if you take log for this, so it will be 3 by 2 log of e to the power of alpha to the base 10, right? So therefore, let us replace this equation as log of lambda to the base 10 is equal to a plus, in the place of log of r to the base 10, let us write it as 3 by 2, this constant b as it is, into log of e to the e alpha to the base 10. So this is nothing but, that is, this equation is nothing but Geiger-Nuttall law, okay, in terms of energy. Okay, so this is a little bit important concept. It may be, there is a range concept is important, there is range of alpha particle is important, Geiger-Nuttall law is important, and these are all very small topics. Okay, we can easily learn, no problem. Okay, so in the next video we'll be discussing some of the other concepts of alpha decay. So thank you.